I think, materializing the ramifications of the history of slavery in its massive extent in this world. She is also one of the motivating forces behind this film. And so she starts off by making some comments about what led to the making of this wonderful film, Mami's Fondé, for which I would like personally to thank you. For people who are lucky enough to know Mami's a little bit, it's a gift to have her on film.
Thank you. You have it?
Yes.
Well, the idea about the film, César had died, you know, 2 years before, and there had been nothing. And I was really afraid. I was thinking, oh my God, this is going to happen, or someone will be some disability or any families, and nothing will happen now. And in 2011 was the 10-year anniversary of the Taubira law. So we could really play a lot of guilt trip and push for some 2 or 3 scenes. And we got the money, we got the producer being interested in making the film and found the director. It was very nice because we worked very well. Because I was really afraid, it was very important to find the right person to do the film. And so since I was the one to write it, I wanted not to focus only on Maggie's as a writer, but what is to be a woman, what is to be a black woman, what is to be, you know, the relation with Guadeloupe, the relation with Africa, the relation with slavery, memory, as activism, as a mother, as a friend, and everyone was, you know, the privilege of being a friend, the results, friendship is very important for her. So that was one of the first things. Then the second thing was we wanted to evoke the triangle, and at the beginning we're supposed to do Paris, Dakar, and Guadeloupe. But Mami did not want to go to Guadeloupe anymore, so Guadeloupe out. And then there was some difficulty to go to Dakar at that time, so we could not go to Dakar. But anyway, I wanted to have done those 3 places, so it was New York, Paris. And then we got invited in French Guiana. And in fact, that was very interesting, because French Guiana is very rarely on the map. And the fact that we could meet with the Baron community was extraordinary also. So that was the second thing. And the way the film is conducted, that you never hear my question. You know, I don't have to appear. So it was, and she's speaking to us as, so that was also the principle of the film that you and using also people like Raoul Beck or Eric Orsena or other people, that will also trigger conversation with us, which will express some view. So that was also one of the way we went through it. And so the thing was, and also Jordan, at that same year, I wanted also to, before that, Magnus was publishing books and nobody was talking about it anymore in the French newspaper. Barely. So I say, we have to do something, this is important. So I organized also the ceremony that we see in the city hall. And the mayor, she lived in the third arrondissement, and the mayor was admired her, so I went to see him and I said, you admire her, do something. And so he opened up, you know, because I know what else. So he did that, and I invited artists to come and read text and all of her, and to do it, really to celebrate her, and they all accepted. So that was also something to do. That was really to say to also a lot of public, there is this writer, she's a very important writer, you should read her again, you should pay attention to what she's saying. It's very important. Don't forget. You're forgetting César, you're forgetting Fanon. Stop forgetting and bring it back. So that was also, and the film was that also, part of the film was to bring it back. So the film was shown on TV, but you know, I don't know, 11:45 p.m. or something like that, so probably you'll see it. So this is why we got some copy, and we started to, in fact, organize a lot of screenings for associations. So we did the work also of distributing the film a lot because we were ahead. And then we showed it first at NYU, but it was not subtitled, so I realized we had to subtitle it, so we wanted to be here for the US. So it was also looking for money again, and so it has been a really process to bring them to the and I have to say that Mathis, the first, we invited Mathis and her family and some friends. There was a premiere at La Fémis where Paul Beck is the writer. And it was very important because it was the first time. I did not want her to see anything before. So, and they all love it, so that was very, I was very, yeah, that was, and she liked the film, she liked it very much. So, and then after that, when she started to talk, when she's with Eric Porcena, that she had been thinking about the book. And at the beginning, effectively, she wanted to explore the place of Africa and the wild world. But she said, this is why I can say that, she said publicly that in fact the film triggered the desire to tell about her story, her own life, and she was very self-aware about these years. And it was, because she started to talk about her childhood, her life, her relation with Africa, her relation with her first husband, with Michel, and so on, that she wanted, in fact, to write something about it. And she, for those of you who have read that so far, it was also, she started by saying, a lot of things have been said about me, and I let them go, you know, I let them, so and it's a lot of invention, so I'm going to set the record straight. But it's what I saw. And I thought that was also interesting as in what the film did for her in the past. I don't know what I have to say.
All right, so let's introduce our distinguished panelists here. And maybe we'll go in the opposite direction here, just to create some movement. I'll introduce it. I'll probably to this audience, they need no introduction, but I will very brief introductions. Nandanta Diallo, I'll introduce all of you in the news. Naminata Diabate is currently a literature, and she's an assistant professor in the comparative literature department here. Next year, she is a very creative scholar of African and Caribbean literature, and particularly the figures of women and the bodies of women, the exposed bodies of women in African film and literature. Carol Boyce-Davies really needs no introduction. Preeminent feminist scholar of Africa, the Caribbean, the diaspora in general, African America, feminism, and we cannot think about black feminism without referring to at least three of her books. So we're very happy to have you here, depending on the commentator and Marie-Claire Valois, distinguished professor the French department, also an important feminist thinker and a specialist in the earlier periods of literature, and if we're thinking of some of the 10 great women in Françoise's exhibition, Léonard de Gouges would be a figure that Marie-Claire Valois would be able to tell us about. Last but by no means least, Kavita Singh, who recently completed her PhD here in comparative literature, a Caribbeanist working in French and English primarily. She's currently a fellow at the Jackman Humanities Institute at the University of Toronto. And some of us just recently read her chapter on the creative take on the Creole performative dimension of the autobiographical voice in all of Nandi's work. So welcome to you all. I'd like to have some time for your reactions and questions to Françoise or to any of the panelists regarding Mathis Condé and related issues. So.
Okay, I mean, thank you for this introduction, and I'm truly honored to be sitting here and engaging with Françoise Gage's work. I'm originally from the Ivory Coast, and I grew up, you know, reading and listening to Françoise Gage my whole life. So, seriously. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, my response to Mathis Condé's work in general, and to this documentary in particular, is to prompt. It's first and foremost a personal reaction, and the academic reaction, you know, comes second. So my comment, this brief comment, is just going to be a personal one. I want to try to situate that comment within the broader context of decolonizing the mind that Maryse Condé might have participated in the African context. I encountered Maryse Condé's work in the 1980s when I was in primary school in the Ivory Coast. And I encountered it through the novel Ere Makono, her first novel, which was published in 1976. And Ere Makono in Malinke, my first native language, means, as it was rightly translated, waiting for happiness. And as a grad student in the Ivory Coast, I was going to a school that privileged the French language and everything French as the way to modernization and development. So if, for example, you were speaking your own native language, because there were several of us, some speaking Malinke, like myself, some speaking Bahuli or Bete, if you are caught speaking your native language, there is a penalty attached to that. The teacher will make you wear a necklace made of vegetables. And the whole day, you will have your peers make fun of you as the Bushman or as the Bushwoman. I am not kidding. This is not a made-up story. And it depends probably on the neighborhood where I was not coming from, you know, middle class, so it's a different story altogether. And so it's in that context that I briefly saw Ere Makono. And for the first time in my life, it came to me that, oh, my native language actually could be on the cover of a book. So in that sense, that novel, the title already, I wasn't learning enough in French to read it at that time. I eventually read it when I was in college. And then, you know, I understood the complexity that went into the making of that novel. But the title already of that Ere Makono, you know, Malinke word, you know, introduced that she was a disorder in the way I looked at the world, because the educational system that I was part of was sending me a message that was making me, well, I'm making him somehow. So this title already, that was enough. Already told me that I was where I was coming from, the language that I was speaking mattered somehow. So this is the kind of work that her writings did that probably she's not aware of, because I have never shared this with anybody else. So it's this roundtable that gave me the opportunity. But any time that I see Maryse Condé, this is the first reaction that I have to her work and to herself as a scholar, as an activist. And I'm going to stop here for now. And the question that I have for Françoise Vergès is, the darlings that you had to kill in order to make this film, because we understand a tremendous amount of mutilation that goes into describing an iconic figure such as Maryse Condé. So I wonder, are there aspects of her life that you would have loved to see this documentary, but given the constraint of, you know, the genre and the length, are there things that you left out that you would like to share with us? Thank you.
Thank you too for the opportunity and the introduction. A couple connections that are really critical, as Nana has indicated. As a grad student, I had a Commonwealth scholarship to the University of Nevada, and I studied African literature. This was an African Caribbean literature study. And one evening, one of my professors invited me to the senior staff club to meet Maryse Condé. So I met her as a grad student. She had just finished writing that novel. And as normally as you know, a grad student meeting a famous writer, feel all the intimidations and so on. But she was amazingly wonderful, asking what I was working on. I was happy that I was from the Caribbean in Africa doing the work I was doing. And really affirmed my work and said, go with that. And I think she was right. So I want to thank her She knows. The second one is really strange. When I was at Binghamton years ago, I think it may have been just before Maurice went to Columbia, around the time I got a letter from Columbia University. And Columbia has an interesting system when they're trying to hire somebody, they get letters from different people. You're supposed to comment and ask and indicate if that person is as good as X. And I got a letter like that from Maurice Condé. I was amazingly angry. And they wanted to know if she liked Toni Morrison, if she liked this one, if she liked that person. And so one has to, in that context, write a very careful indication about how important this writer is and how you can't compare it to any of those people in those ways. So those are two interesting connections that I have, one as a student and one as now a prof being asked to do something impossible like that. So I was reminded in the film when the prof from Columbia talked about her and said that they were told she had a prickly personality and so on. And we've heard this about Ahmad Chaibu, we've heard this about Toni Morrison, we've heard this about every black woman who raises a response to any kind of humiliation, you get to be the prickly one. So I thought it was interesting that she is always affirmative, and in the interview with the first interview you showed in the Persian context about her work, she challenged the interviewer back in terms of what he was saying about her work, whether there was violence in it, and so on. So it was not surprising that she came back to see that she is a Fanonian. A couple of things struck me as I viewed the film. Now, she said she wanted to find her own language and that she was working towards that. She was writing in Maurice. I thought that was really significant. She also talked about mobility as being central, and those of us who work on Caribbean subjects know the extent to which the logic of migration is part of the framing of Caribbean identity. And I mean, there's so many scholars from Stuart Hall to Fanon to Cézanne, to everybody who has engaged this question. And one can look at it from many different points of view. So I'm not surprised that she has discomfort with Guadeloupe for different reasons. But that is something that I think we can come back to at some point. I was quite struck that she was really insisting on, but also not surprised, the category of Francophone studies in the university, but I do understand why. And then she indicated that the point was that they wouldn't study Cézanne, but this was the means by which she would teach them about who Cézanne and others were. So she seemed to be taking that framing then and then flipping it in a way that got utility out of it. I thought, interestingly, too, in the film, one got a clear sense of Guadeloupean class, black class structure. And she makes this very clear. I mean, you can have that similar kind of point coming from somebody like Leon Damas, also French Guyana, when he talked about this in the poem Hiccups, where he talks about his mother wanting him not to play with the black children outside, or not to speak patois, or learn how to eat with the implements appropriately, and so on. And his famous, my mother wanted me to be very dofa, so Latin here and so on. But the question of a class structure within the larger black population is critically raised in the film. And importantly, that she positions her own family as part of that, having a maid that would take them around and not being able to mix with the local black population and so on. At first, it seemed to me that she was saying that Paris was not hostile encounter for her, but she clarifies this substantially. And I was thinking when I saw it initially that it seems the initial encounter was a little bit different from how Fanon phrased his encounter, you know, the little nigger comment. But she replaces that initial assumption very early by clarifying how, as she grew to understand the way that race worked in Paris and various encounters, that Paris would be, racism in Paris was absolutely part of the framework of things. I liked her ongoing engagement with Haiti and why. And her point about having never seen in history that much suffering in such a small place, we see that repeated even now in the way that Haiti is still positioned, the various encounters following the earthquake.
and so on. The work of Edwidge Nancy Cabot picks that up even more directly. Now, what I loved about the film is that she is able to talk about her loves and her romances and very, she doesn't give names, but she goes into pretty good detail. So she identifies herself both in terms of her personal life, her sexual life, and how one makes those choices. And for women, that is often an issue as a professional, as a writer, as an academic, how one navigates that space of the personal and the political. And she does that really well as well. Particularly talking about falling in love with an Englishman and how that worked when she was a black nationalist, talking about that, about issues that have to do with challenging white identity. I see her clarification then of herself towards the end as being a feminist, still maintaining a communist sensibility is really significant as well. She says, consistently always trying to find a way to understand who she is. I find that really significant, the way that she phrases it. What I love too visually, and I was chatting about this, is the presentation of Madame Jo. And we were saying they look almost like family, they look alike. When you look at the facial structure of the two women, and that the camera was able to capture the color and the skin tone and the presence as well, seeing a black woman in a very elegant way. I want to compliment you for that a little bit. And many of us who love Madame Jo, we're just happy to see her on screen too, since Marie's Kondo. I wanted to ask you then, and I mean, I don't have any major question, but I noticed you worked it all the way back to ending with Marcus Garvey. This point of Marie saying that Garvey said he wanted to teach the black man to see beauty in himself. And especially since she's a feminist, why would you use that? What about a black woman seeing beauty in herself? Yeah, that's just a provocative question, but it's one that I do understand why you chose.
Well, I feel that I am one of the least competent to really comment about Marie Condé's. I don't know her, I have not read all her books, but I accepted to come because I have taught Marie Condé's novels, and I have found that it's always a really one of the best way to give my student a sense of another world in the language they can grasp. What I was really interested in the way you were presenting the film was the question of language. The fact that she decided to speak in French, a language which was the language of the colonizer, of the oppressed. And the way that the way she kind of used and appropriated that language through her life and in her books, so that in at the end of the movie, when Sarkozy speaks to honor the Bois de Pilar, it seems like he's almost speaking like her. Ils furent enchaînés, humains. It's almost like a Marie Condé's line. So what I was really interested in was that how this work of translation, how she has had that work of translation, and how she has reappropriated French, the language of the colonizer, to make it talk her discourse through the president of the French Republic. I thought that was really a moment of joy, an enjoyment moment, that she had, precisely in choosing, and she explained why, writing fiction, she writes fiction because it's much easier to let her revision of the history of the black and the diaspora understood. When I heard the President Sarkozy said this, I said, she really succeeded. She really made him speak her language. And I really saw that when she said, she talked about Francophonie, and the African reappropriated French I think a whole lot of novels, although they are in French, she says, I don't speak French, I speak Marianne Condé, Marie Condé. That's what she did. She made Crazy Nurse Sarkozy speak Marie Condé. And I really thought that was an incredible, the way you organize the movie so that this would come out at the end, I really thought that was really marvelous. I will stop here so I could say quite a few more things. The other thing I wanted to say is that I was struck by one of the comments by Gisson saying that the Creole conteur says, never say I want, but they say mon corps, my body, when they tell their story. I was struck when I heard that, how did Marie Condé redid that when she wrote moi, I, Tituba, Sorcière, Witch of Salem. In a certain way, what she did there was something very tricky and successful. And she rewrote the way of telling a story by using the moi. Of course, the moi is not her, it's both her and Tituba. Like I'm displacing that moi and that I, and writing the story, telling the tale of Tituba, Sorcière of Salem, again, it's a bit to ask for. Making that language and that moi being both individual and completely collective. I thought that was, in a certain way, also something which, in somewhat in the film, you really translate. She was both talking as an individual, but also as a collective. And that was another, I think, tour de force that she had. I guess I'll stop here. I had one question about when she says, I am a fan of Yen, and maybe if you could give us a few more details about that.
For example, how she met her first husband and how she ended up in Africa, which was not as she used to claim. claim, and I should kind of think in this film to follow him once he had married. Or why it took her so long to complete her studies, not as she had previously written because of her rebellious spirit, but because she unexpectedly became a mother. In Victoire, the Mother of My Mother, she ends the first chapter with the overt declaration, as it is, and this is my terrible translation, as it is, I deliver the portraits that I was able to retrace, but I absolutely do not guarantee neutrality or accuracy. Condé carefully blurs a line between her life and her fictions, making of herself a fluid center of many provocative stories of Black women's lives that would mark her writing. Her writing, I should note, that is both in and out of her native Guadeloupe. And this we can see in this film, which takes place, as you noted, in New York City, Paris, and French Guiana, but in which Guadeloupe figures instead as a painful loss. So why should it matter that Condé's writing is so autobiographical? We could insist on many writers' biographical circumstances, their social, geographic, national, and familial racial determinations, and this offers perhaps one lens of interpretation. Yet, you must remember that Condé comes out of a French Caribbean literary tradition, with Aimé Césaire arguably as a founding figure, and with those unforgettable words from his Cahier, I would go to this land of mine and I would say to it, embrace me without fear, and if all I can do is speak, it is for you I shall speak. After Césaire, the writer has been positioned time and again as a spokesperson for the entire culture, as a voice of the people. Writing in the French Caribbean has largely been a practice of writing in the French Caribbean, such that the self is suppressed before the weak of country. Yet Condé has refused to suppress the self, which we can consider is what allows her to write as a woman in exile, as a non-Creole speaking child of the Black bourgeoisie. She herself has written extensively on how none of these subject positions are allowed in the narrative of country, how they are unwelcome among the voices that would speak for those others, which I might note are frequently figured as masculine, working class, and Creole. In answer to the manufactured mythologies, Condé has found it more pressing to seek in her writing what she calls her own truths, somewhere between fiction and her lived experience, a truth for which the index is not fact or reality, but which answers only to those questions that she has grappled with in her own very interesting life. And by no means do I mean to suggest that those questions do not also include country. Thus, coming back to the film, I'm fascinated by the place of truth-telling. Although I've just represented Condé's writings as somewhat, always somewhere between her life story and her lack of fictions, I see a new moment for Condé's practice with the arrival of both this film and the memoirs. And it's interesting to hear that they were somewhat linked. And this new moment is where Condé reveals many secrets of her long trajectory across various continents, letting them come to the fore without, as far as we can tell, the same degree of invention and embellishment as before. This is where I would like to ask Madame Regis to comment perhaps on Condé's shift from masking, from carefully reconstructing her life story for her audience, to a more explicit revelation of very poignant and difficult events in her past. Thus, in La Vie sans Phare, Condé appears to put into writing many moments of her own personal history, formerly buried by rebellious fictions. In Marie's Condé, a voice of her own, this film, we are given a visual revelation, those telling moments where she reacts with deep pleasure to the praise of others, where she expresses her hurt at the lack of recognition in her homeland, where she hints at the transformative effect of her first Haitian love affair, that it had on her life, and she does reveal his name in the memoir, by the way. So you should read it. I want to ask Madame Regis, who has here taken the place of the writer, which the film's credit tells us, right, what it means to become, perhaps, the only other writer of Marie Condé's life, to write Marie Condé's voice, as a title of the film would suggest, it's a voice of her own. And I grab here that perhaps her husband and Richard Philcox is perhaps one of the few other people who has had such a role. I'm also curious as to what lies behind this decision and perhaps desire to reveal her secrets. I think you've already addressed that to some extent. To reveal her secrets, her weaknesses, her vanity along with her vulnerability, not only through her own words now, but also through a portrait that is composed of her various faces, younger and older, her various voices, younger and older. This is one of the things I loved about the film, that we can see Is there an aspect of the penchant for exchange that we see highlighted in this film that allows her to now welcome various narratives in the representation of her life and her work, various voices? Has she finally decided that her story, her voice, although still of herself, is no longer simply for herself, because she previously said she writes for herself, but that her story, although not a representation of anyone else, can also now be for and of others? I would also like to add to that question, I would love to hear you talk more about Sakusi, because there's a moment at the beginning where she mentions, she expresses her sentiments for Sakusi, and then we see him at the end, I love how he said, sort of, he speaks her. I would love, you know, just any juicy.
Thank you very much for your comments.
Well, thank you for all these comments.
So, what other aspect of Mary's life?
Probably the juicy stories.
Yeah. Well, I kind of know more about Guadeloupe and the question of Guadeloupe. Mary's was a candidate in some, you know, local election. She went through a campaign, a town campaign. There was a very tense relation with Guadeloupe, and I was in Guadeloupe, there was some resentment from the Guadeloupean towards her, and there was some kind of, as you say, what's happened in our island, of this incredible complex relation that we can have, of being rejected and nonetheless wanting to remain the daughter of this island. And it's really something that, and I would have loved more about that. We could not even interview someone who it was too problematic. It was much problematic. But first, because if we had chosen that one, oh my God, we would have heard from all the wives, and at the second, that one thing. Then second, we weren't sure about what they would say, and either they would say, oh, she's the best person, and so on, and it would appear to have TV show. So it was a very touchy thing that, in fact, this big elephant in the room was one of them. And the fact that we could not go, that was very, so for me, it remained something that I would have loved. What about this guy there? Marie's talk about Marcus Garvey many times. I thought it was perhaps a certain black nationalism still here, but that she does not acknowledge really completely because she does not want. And I tried to get her to speak, but as I said, Tony Morrison, Sigmund Schwarzbaum, and trying to get it but voila, it was Marcus Garvey. And in a way, it was interesting because the quote of Marcus Garvey is not really that. It's like, I shall teach a black man to see beauty in his own kind. And I thought it was interesting that he is switched in his own kind into in himself, because I thought it reflected much more what Marcus was talking about, her own journey through her own self-discovery of seeing beauty in herself, and therefore to be able to see beauty in everyone. I thought it was interesting that the stage report was not exactly what Garvey has been saying. Madame Diop, following that, I wanted also to do a portrait. Madame Diop, I absolutely love her very much. She's a magnificent person. But then that was also, this is why I was happy to do the film prize all day, because then you enter with a children's story and family songs and a lot of all that. So. I cannot be juicy with that. The Sarkozy made 10 things. Okay, first I have to give the background. This was the 10-year anniversary of the Loi de Vivre. It was very important to do that. So for instance, the year before, I started to go in the association and say, we have to push for a very true celebration. If we don't push, we will not do it. They will hear us. So we have to show that we are there and we want a real commemoration. We want the highest person, the President of the Republic, to come to say what France owed to the slave. What is the debt of France to the slave? Not that slavery was blah, 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 but what without the slave, you will not be what you are. That that the state gave to liberté, égalité, fraternité, really the true sense. So we got, so we prepared things and so on. So when we went to the Élysée, we already, you know, like a movement was like that. But the Élysée was quite convinced quite easily, but the point was that after the content, you know what it was. And we asked them to have a stem, you know, in which, on which it's written, that without the slave, the notion of liberté, égalité, fraternité would not have the meaning they had, and the human rights that you that France is so proud about will not be also what they are. Which was, I'm not sure that they understood what they are, they were doing, that, what we were making them do, but they accepted it. So, it was very important for us. It was, it's a very conservative president. He was a very conservative president.
That's right.
And that's it. What that president would say that was very important. And there was then, after the issue of the speech, what he gonna say, you know, what, how he's gonna say. And as I say again, we wanted the 10th anniversary, we wanted to be there. Because I was thinking the following year would be the election, the presidential election, we would have a new president, and possibly would be never have another opportunity to do something like that. So thousands of people showed up. There was some incident with the anti-necrophobia brigade that was expelled from the garden. So there was, but nonetheless, it was 1,000 people, and then it's paid for everything. It was a lot of work for people. And we had also we suggested that you had archive, you know, presented. An act of slave or a slave, about Marilyn and so on. And for the first time, this was shown to the president of the family, from where to the other, and was a friend of us who did them busy. So it was really a ceremonial that, you know, through which we wanted to have, and this was, of course, since it was a president, was filmed, you know, on TV and that. So it was for us. And I remember some people told me, but this is Sarkozy, and I said, I don't think the president of the Republic, what do you want? You elected him, you know, so what kind of people do you want? I have to work with him, you know, Alexander, as we say. But, so, in the speech, okay, this is where the answer I can say. But, because we, I mean, I wanted really the speech. But you were right, because it was, I think, one of the best speech he had. I don't know if he was sincere, I don't care. But I have to say that all the people who were there, many of them on the left or the left, just came and told me that they had nothing either bad to say about the speech. They could not. Even Toby Harkestian, kind of slap Sarkozy, she said, you know, congratulations, congratulations. So there was something that happened, effectively, but I think it was a very difficult marriage, but also all the work abroad that we have done for years of really finally getting somewhere for that moment, like I said, because for this year it was not like that. But it's there. It's there, there, and so that we did something. It was very, so that was also important, that marriage had to be there, that Christian to be hard to be there. And we were had to be on the front row, even though all of them were there, because Sarkozy required all the ministers to be there. So all the government were there. And that is what's front row and presented. So two black women, front row, you know. So it was a kind of ceremony, you know, with a lot of symbolic meaning that, you know, perhaps we're not really there for a lot of people before as well. Very important. So besides the speech, it was also that ceremony. The fact that the president of the government would say this word, the fact that it was, you know, the archive was there, for the first time the archive was shown, you know, that he had to look at them and be there. The fact that the two black women were there on the front row, you know, all these things were like something that in each detail were worked with the protocol. It's not really a question, but why I wanted to. The conversation with Marlies were quite important, and I think, you know, I have picture that she would open the drawer and things like that. So it was really, and I think that it was like, became possible. And she started to say things that I was not, you know, expecting, you know. So, you know, then I went on pushing and pushing, you know, and she kind of accepted it. And when something happens, it goes through the question of, in fact, the self-reflection in yourself. That what you say, that, you know, drop a little of the, you know, of a certain personal Marie's, a certain figure that she has constructed, and people have constructed, and this double movement has constructed a certain Marie's. And I wanted to also to, that's something which showed, I think, she had a tough life, I mean, I knew a little about it. And this has also to come up, and this is a woman, which is not a character in a novel. And we have to understand that the life really she had, the courage she had, the breath would be incredible. But at the same time, that was tough, that she suffered. She suffered a lot. She's a woman who suffered a lot. And I think this is what also quite often she talked about suffering. She suffered a lot. The years in Africa were very tough, really, really tough. There was things that she said about Africa that we did not really want to put under the fact that she was rejected by the family and the husband because she was not an African. She tried twice like that, she tried all those things, and they could even talk to her. She was very, she told me that sometimes it was really tough. She was with her children. Her husband was leaving for the day, sometimes for weeks, you know, and she was like, with the mother-in-law and the sister-in-law, and nobody was talking to her. And it's so, and she was quite in her 20s. Far from her family, you did not have even the phone at the time, she could not call her family, she did not, she was not even, she didn't, she told me she had not got into home, not get to talk to. And then after she started to beat her life and have friends, and she mentioned what she said. Change, but I wanted also that I wanted that we love her for who she is, and not for who we want her to be, and that she is lovable as she is, and she doesn't have to hide behind you know, some persona. I suppose this was a starting for her to want to say more about herself. And she felt that yes, she could say that, she could speak about herself without, you know, fearing judgment or fearing that for, that some that she will lose something. You know, it changed her. It really changed her the process. The team was very, I mean, the cameraman was absolutely sweet. It would be a very small team because it has to be constantly a little intimate. And they were very sweet with her, so she started to feel, she followed the camera, she was starting, you know, so it started to be really possible for her to see. When she speaks about her children, when she speaks about her husband, when she speaks about Trisha, when she speaks about the Haitian lover, which was as she's a terrible story, but so yes, I think it's what gave her the desire. About you coming from the back of the class, because I absolutely have no idea what your story. I mean, really. really, we don't need that generation still to then be discovering. I think to go to Paris to discover that there is Africa exists, there's a history, there's a slave trade. I think it's also important to speak more and more about that. She had already spoken about that, but now she really could speak about it without anger, without resentment, without frustration. That was the word.
So we have about 10 minutes or so for your questions, comments, or anything you'd like to add. That I'd like to thank all the panelists for a really rich, concise, generous intervention, and Françoise for your own generous responses. And who should and could be on the panel for it.
Therefore, I'll take 9 of the 10 minutes. First of all, it's congratulations on a wonderful film. I'm glad to hear about the memoir because I haven't read it, but I think that anyone who's interested ought to see the movie first. even though the film is in one way a construction of Marie Courtney, memoirs and autobiography are also a construction, another kind of performance. So I would find more believable, more credible, the construction by an outside person who knows her or a team and who are looking at her from the outside. Her point about Marise's point about trying to find myself. I'm glad that was a kind of theme, and I think that the Garvey quote at the end, I see how it fits because I see Condé's novels, particularly the first 4 or 5, as trying to find herself or the diaspora self. The diaspora self. And so that's what Garvey said. And the fact that that Condé acknowledges, she says, I'm really not that much of a feminist. We want to make her a feminist, but she says, and we can look at some of her writings too and critique it that way. And so I think that the choice of a Garvey quote reminds us that Condé is a black person, a person of the African diaspora, but who is a product of all of the travels and exchanges. At the very beginning, she says it's exchange that really makes us who we are, makes an individual who he or she is. And so I think the film shows that, and I think that's an interesting way to reflect on the earliest novels anyway, because it is a search. I mean, whether it's Tree of Life where there are a couple of characters, but they're searching in some historical contexts, certainly not alone as the other. So I don't have a question, I just wanted to make those comments and thank you again. Is the film going to go to Ouagadougou? I know you're not trying to compete with anybody, but it needs to be in a film festival like that.
Well, thank you very much. It was very important for me. I really didn't want to think that we show Marie is the most important writer or tar. Because I think I would be bored myself by the film, it was to be a film I wanted to see. And so I wanted also to show her own contradiction, the fact that, she tried to answer to some question, personal question, and collective question in her own way. And I think that we can have a good book and us, and we thought there are things that we do not agree, but that's okay, that's part of the things. It was very, very important for me. And I think if it had been done by someone from the Caribbean, I think, really, without doing it. because the relation would be more complicated, and so you would need either a iconic figure or whatever, or it would be some kind of
And she really was kind of devastated at the reception she got or didn't get when she returned to the booth. It was really because I spoke to her, I think, sometime within like 2 years after they came back, and she was really not quite bitter, but really devastated.
It was, it's really a love affair.
Yeah.
I mean, the chapter she wrote is some kind of a love, betrayed by your love.
Yeah.
So she's really, there is something, of a love betrayed. But what I said, it's the same feeling on the other side. The same feeling on the other side. That they loved her and she betrayed them. She did not return her love that she had given her. So it's a real, this is why I say it's in a way of this society, the relation with their daughter, with them, with the woman, and so on. It's not as it's go around that, almost a total love affair and a misunderstanding and a mutual accusation.
Any more questions? Comments?
I think there was one about from you wanted to
what makes her
phenomenal? Yes, what makes her phenomenal?
I think I understand, but
how did
she kind of talk more about
that during the... not so much during the film, but we've been talking about her family, and she really said that... I think what she appeared in the Isaac Julian movie on the panel, right? Because already I wanted her to be. And I think what for her family was effectively beyond race, and the possibility of also bringing all the piece of her life together that will not be under race. So I think that final was that was very important for her in that way. All Blacks and White Masks, of course, and the Wrench of the Birds is really final and famous new humanism, how you go beyond, and I think that what is important for her. Whereas she would, as she says, Cesar, with never to fear that he would be again under race, nonetheless. And she, that's very important for her. That has been very, very important that she, this is what, in the conversation she comes back. But in the movie itself, she just said that it was, that she became really feminine for that. I mean, she talked also more about Marxism, and she was, she had been a Marxist, and she remained to a certain extent a Marxist in the sense of, believing in the fact you have a social class and class struggle. And so I think that's also, also closer to family.
We have one more chance. Speak now or speak later in privacy.
Thank you so very much.